have a PC-10 and you can have even a nucleus drop as well. So I just did a converted one half into a capsulorhexis, the other half into a capsulorhexis, and then went ahead and did the phacoemulsification in the anterior chamber, making sure that the viscoelastic viscoat was taking care of the endothelium. But I don't mind losing some endothelial cells, but I don't want that rhexis tear to go to the back across the equator to the posterior capsule to prevent a nucleus drop. So this is the way you manage an Argentina flag sign, provided the cataract is not very dense. Fortunately for me, this cataract was not very dense, and this patient wanted a multifocal. I didn't put a multifocal lens. I just put a unifocal hydrophilic lens into the bag, and the patient did well. Now I'm going to tell you one very simple method of overcoming this Argentina flag sign. If you don't have access to the femtocataract is probably the best, but you know how costly it is. This is called the punctorhexis, which you have developed. It's a very, very simple technique. What you do is, you just go bevel down, use a 0 degree or a 15 degree tip, go bevel down, and you can see the parameters on top. What I'm using, use a high vacuum burst of phaco and punch the rhexis. If you punch the rhexis, you can see here, it not only takes care of the interlateral pressure, rapidly decompresses the interlateral pressure, but also it debulks the nucleus as well. You can see here, this is a debulking because of the burst of the phaco. You can see one more video on this where I'm using a bevel down 15 degree tip, and if you see the very carefully how I'm punching it with using a burst of phaco using a high vacuum. And then once you punch it, sit back and use any molecule, any viscoelastic like HPMC, then you can convert this punch rhexis into a regular rhexis by using a Wootretta forceps, whatever you are comfortable with, and or with a cystitome, and whichever size you want. Normally in intermittent cataract or mature cataract, you always aim for a smaller size. Here in punch rhexis, you don't have to do that. You can go in, again you can see here, the most important thing is to punch right in the center and go one full throttle down on your phaco foot switch. If you go half throttle, what will happen is, there is some time for the nucleus to come forward. What happens is, there are two compressors, I told you. One is a pressure in front, another is a pressure is behind. And also the nucleus is bigger and bulkier. So the nucleus, as soon as you release the pressure, the nucleus tries to come forward and extend the rhexis margin on either side, and that's why you get an Argentina flag sign. To prevent that, what you do is, you punch the rhexis, you punch the nucleus as well. You can see the punch in the nucleus as well in this. Can you see the center? If you see the center, you can see the punch in the nucleus, and that actually debulks the nucleus. This is actually a flare tip. Somebody was asking me whether we can use a flare tip or a Kelvin tip. Flare tip, it's better to use a bevel down straight tip, not a flare tip or a Kelvin tip. Kelvin tip definitely will not work for punctorhexis, and that is the reason why I thought I will this thing. Or if you want to just convert, this is a patient you can see here. What I thought was, convert this punctorhexis into a phacorhexis as well. With the phaco needle itself, once you punch it, you can decompress with the phaco needle, because the phaco needle is much bigger and it decompresses the interlenticular pressure very, very fast. So that is the reason why you can go ahead and using the second instrument or the Sinsky hook, you can go double-handed technique and do the phacorhexis as well. Or in this case, you can see here how it has been done with the phaco needle, and you don't require a cystitome or a Wootretta forceps. So this is one thing I just wanted to show you. Then another thing is how to management of a PCR. This you can see here, this video was taken in 2007 when one of my phaco trainees was doing a phaco case, and he didn't notice that this is a PCR because he caught the posterior end of the capsular this thing, and also the nucleus was sinking. What is more important is, when you have a PCR, what normally you do? You do it when you become jittery. You might be operating on a VAP patient or something like that. But what you should not do is to come out of the eye like that. When it comes out of the eye, the rhexis the tear becomes, what is the tear, which is initially about 2 or 3 millimeter, has become a huge tear. And then I went in and did a bimanual anterior vitrectomy. And fortunately for me, the nucleus started coming up and I got the nucleus out, and then I supported that with the second instrument and phacoed that, and then removed the vitreous. At that time in 2007, we didn't have the advantage of having the preservative-free tricot, but we just do a bimanual vitrectomy, clear the vitreous first, okay, use a high cutting rate, clear the vitreous first in the pupillary area, and then do a bimanual IA to remove the cortex as well, as I can see here in this case. So the anterior chamber maintainer, I can see here, this is an anterior chamber maintainer, and you keep changing the instruments on your right side only, and either the cutter or the bimanual IA aspirator, that is the aspiration, and remove the cortex, and then go ahead and put the lens in the sulcus, not a single piece lens or a multi-piece lens in the sulcus. So this is, again you can see here, this is a patient I operated about 15 years back. When I was taking the last piece of the nucleus, you can see here that there was a posterior capsular tear. You're able to see that, I suppose. And this is because of the post-occlusion surge at that time in 2000, when I was about 16 years back. At that time we had only the first generation or second generation phaco machines, which had lot of surge as well. But what is more important, I didn't lose my calm. I injected viscote through the side port here. I injected viscote through whichever viscoelastic, viscote will make your life easy, because this viscote will go and plug the PC tear. And also, by using a bimanual IA, it will prevent the hydration of the vitreous and preventing the tear from becoming a very big tear. So these two points I just wanted, the punctonexus and the PC tear, I thought I will tell you in this particular session. Thank you very much, Kumar.
Thank you, Dr. Mohan Rajat.